Get called in by a friend to play a 3.5 game set in the Dragonlance setting. Never read anything about it before, but that's okay because apparently we're playing the exact plot of the first three books. Read through the background lore and note it's a pretty classic light versus dark high fantasy world, with heavy emphasis on the gods. Said gods are major dicks who nuked the planet then disappeared for 300 while mortals to rebuild civilization, decide to play an elf wizard who's old enough to have grown up right in the wake of the cataclysm and has studied history extensively to know just how petty the gods can be. You see, they threw a giant flaming mountain at us because good won too hard and tried to destroy all evil. The balance has to be preserved, and mass extinction was the best solution our nearly omnipotent masters could come up with. Fuck. That. Be Borkurth, Red Wizard of the Tower of High Sorcery, Master Transmuter, and the guy who has a real chip on his shoulder when it comes to the gods. Party all meets in an inn to play our DM's War of the Lance self-insert fanfic. While I've obviously read the setting materials, I've been a good little goober and avoided spoilers. At most I've been told by my DM that I have somehow independently made myself a perfect stand-in for this guy, and anyone who's read Dragonlance is probably laughing their ass off right now. Wanna guess what the fucking plot of the first three Dragonlance books is? Spoiler alert. One of the PCS in the party turns out to be the very first cleric ordained by the gods of good after their 300-year absence. He needs to rekindle the faith of the world and find the orbs of dragonkind so we can fight against the resurgent gods of evil and their armies of draconian monsters. I think the DM intended for my character's arc to be all about realizing that Jesus really does love me. Not going to be that easy, friend. Lawful neutral isn't my alignment, it's my manifesto. Instead, I invite our new pope in training to play chess with me each night during the downtime in our quest to stop the forces of darkness. Using transmutation, I craft a magical game board that allows me to modify the pieces at will. The mind games start when I fashion the white pieces to look like our allies, the Knights of Salamnia, and black pieces to look like our draconian enemies. It only seems appropriate for you to take command of white. Of course, balance must be maintained, so I must lead black against you. Cleric picks up that we're definitely not just playing a game here, and asks what I'm up to. I promise to tell him if he can win against me. Unfortunately for him, the DM ruled that chess falls under the knowledge, games and gambling, skill which only even exists because I took it back at character creation. I actually wanted my chess motifs to be a subtle thing, but look where we are now. Over our many, many matches we banter more and more about theology and what purpose the gods serve. He's comes to see me as a sort of mentor, though my interest in collecting powerful artifacts keeps him wary. I politely ask him if the daily casting of Detect Evil is really necessary. I even bought a set of chess piece shaped dice to roll just for those scenes. Meanwhile, the DM is having the gods of good be increasingly vague in their responses to the cleric's prayers. Kudos to the DM, he's trying to teach the cleric a lesson about faith and trusting in higher powers. Instead, the cleric is becoming increasingly pissed at the number of people dying in this war while the gods waffle on advising the chosen one. More and more often it seems his red-robed friend is the only person able to give him a straight answer. After months of adventures, the dice rolls finally align and the cleric ekes out a win. I ask him what role we have been taking on when we play this game. He catches what I mean and responds that each of us is taking the role of the gods, pitting our followers against each other. I tell him he's correct, and then alter the chessboard. Now many of the white pieces look exactly like our party, with the cleric taking place of the white queen. One thing he notices is that there's no piece on either side that represents me. While he ponders the significance of this, he finds out that when these simulacra clash they actually rip each other apart in combat. Having the corpses of lost pieces remain lying on the field is a nice touch I add to really heighten the brutality. The cleric is suddenly hamstrung as he tries his best to win the match without sacrificing himself or any of his friends. Being the noble sort, he's rather torn between allowing his own piece to be the first taken and knowing how bad of a blow that would be to his chances of winning. Finally, he realizes he has no choice and sacrifices pretty much everyone, but takes the win. So did I pass your test? Have I proven my resolve to see good triumph in this war? No. I just wanted to show you what comes after. At this point, an illusory fireball descends from above and crashes into the chessboard, burning away the remaining pieces and battlefield debris. After a few moments, a new set of pieces rises from the ground. These ones are in shape similar to before, but none of them are familiar. I motion for him to make the first move of our new game, but he just stares at me in horror. Is this the cataclysm? We clear the board just to send more people to die, ask the gods, oh faithful cleric. They want balance, but by their very nature they cannot stop struggling against one another. The last 300 years has been the most peaceful era in all our history, and that was because they left us alone. You're planning something, aren't you? I smile and wave my hand to reveal a multi-layered 3D chessboard. In the very middle, in a spot that allows it to put both the black and white kings in check, is a single red bishop. We are the pieces in this great game, and now you know it's rigged against us. I propose we change the game entirely. The cleric takes in everything I've shown him, and picks up the white queen. Slowly the piece ripples between white and red in his hands, and I wonder if I've managed to convince the first cleric in the Age of Dragons to turn misogynist. I can't believe I'm saying this, but I agree with you. However, the darkness must be kept from overtaking us before we're ready. I must stay here. He places his piece back on the white side of the board. However, when the time comes, I'll be there to help create a true balance. We shake hands and go to sleep before our big mission tomorrow. An elven city is overrun by the nightmares of its king, made real after he attempted and failed to make use of an orb of dragonkind to protect his lands. One by one, the party fails their saving throw and are pulled into their personal nightmares until only the cleric and I remain in the royal throne room. We share a silent look and turn away from each other. The cleric walks to the end of the hall where the king sits comatose on his throne. I slip away through the door that leads to the tower holding the orb. The party overcomes their inner demons and arrives just as the cleric has finished his exorcism on the king. When the party ascends the tower, they find both the orb and their wizard missing. All that remains on the pedestal is a single red chess piece. A bishop. The party has mixed feelings, but generally agrees that I'm probably not trying to betray them. The cleric merely casts detect magic on the bishop, places it in his bag, and calls on the party to get ready to travel to the location of the next orb. Meanwhile, I sit at a desk in one of the many hidden bunkers I've prepared over the years. Before me is an orb of dragonkind, one of the most powerful artifacts ever created on this world. However, I have no intention to use it. It is a large, leather-bound book sitting beside it that is truly special. The book has no proper name yet, but for now I simply call it the Rulebook. Within it are arcane calculations regarding everything that makes up our world. Everything from physics to biology has been painstakingly detailed in its pages. It represents a lifetime of study into the arcane forces that make up the world, and no small amount of the divine as well. With the orb, I now have a proper source of energy to enchant the book and allow it to impose those equations into reality itself. Once that is done, all that remains is to wait for the cleric to find a source of divine magic strong enough to empower the rulebook to its true potential. When next we join together, we will have what we need to issue our ultimatum for the gods. The book will be an artifact capable of sustaining the physical and magical laws of reality, the only service the gods render that makes their removal impossible. They will be asked to surrender their position to our impartial creation, or be removed by force. We will, quite literally, rewrite the rules of our world. Then I notice movement out of the corner of my eye. It appears that one of the white pieces on my chessboard has moved. I smile, mentally congratulating the cleric for discovering the other use for his sending stone so quickly. I take a break from my work to sit down for a rematch. Today's lesson: never play chess with a wizard.
So what gets me the most about this role-playing write-up is we really don't hear much about the campaign at all. Be honest with you, like, you know, what do we really hear? The first we really hear about what's going on is them orbs, like, near the very end. It's all about the chess game, but, like, you know, I really enjoyed it. I thought it was really cool, and there's always a good saying that I like to follow. A story should always be following at the most important or most interesting point at any given time in the universe, you know, and I thought it was really cool. I really enjoyed it, the whole concept of the 3D chess game, and, like, you know, the boy was an excellent example of lawful neutral or really playing any form of neutral character within Leeson, I really enjoyed it. I thought it was so cool. All the chef references and all that type of shit, I really enjoyed it, like, you know. But no, I actually got this one sent in to me. I've never heard of this author before. He's called Kuma9, I believe. Anyway, look, links down below. But it was actually How to PNP sent me this on Twitter. So, like, you know, if you guys have anything, like, the best way to do it is get it on Twitter, because see, if you leave links in YouTube descriptions, YouTube just, they just mark it as spam, and it gets, like, it's just hard to find, you know what I mean? So, like, if you want to give me something, message me on either Twitter or Facebook.
So I've recently moved Nickbeardia merch over to Teesprings and have a few new designs. Listings are below the video and in the description.
Just stop! Just stop it! Stop! No! Just stop it! It's time to stop! It's time to stop, okay? No more! Where the fuck are your parents? Who are your parents? I'm gonna call Child Protective Services! It's time to stop!